What's up, guys? Welcome back to another edition of the Night Report podcast. I'm your host, Richie Schneider. We got a special guest today. Not PJ Carlissimo, JP Carlissimo, very well known on Twitter among the Seton Hall fan base. Almost said Seton Hall. That would have been bad. But yeah, I mean, some Rutgers fans like to say Seton Hall, I guess. But regardless, JP, what's going on, man?
What's up, man? Good to be on. I'm glad we can do this amicably.
Yeah, of course. So Seton Hall Rutgers, the Garden State Hardwood Classic is back this weekend, Saturday night. I think we can all kind of agree 8:30 kind of sucks, but it is what it is, I guess.
I kind of like it. It's better than what last year was, a Sunday at like 1 or 2.
That's
or
true.
Like that. That was the worst. But yeah. Any like Friday, Saturday night, it needs to be, because it's like its own kind of event for everyone, you know, in the area, which is good. Instead of like last year splitting it with, you know, Jets and Giants fans. Everyone's kind of pissed about that, I know.
Yeah, of course. Nice thing is I don't know if the Jets might be at 1 o'clock actually this weekend, so we're going to miss that, but the Giants are on Monday night, so you're also going to miss that. So it kind of all works out, but, regardless, both teams are coming into this one 5-3. And I think my number one question for you to start, and it's the most important question that every Rutgers fan asks me every single time these two teams play each other at Prudential specifically, is the upper deck open?
Dude, it's insane. I don't know why they won't open it. Oh,
it makes
God.
No sense. Yeah,
that's like my favorite chirp going into this game. It's like, open up or down.
Yeah.
Like, I can count on one hand how many times they've done that in however many years. And most of that was when Miles Powell was playing.
Yeah, it's fair. Do we know if it's open this weekend?
But I bet there's probably a portion of it that's going to be open just to get some more people in.
Yeah, of course. I know it just got announced as a sellout, so that's also going to be a big thing. Like I said before, both teams are going into this game 5-3. I'm not really in touch on the Rutgers side because I've already done a recap of that shit show that was the other day versus Wake Forest. But I want to talk about Seton Hall's record this year. We've seen them defeat St. Peter's, Fairleigh Dickinson, Albany. There was a fight in the Wagner game, Northeastern. What do you think so far of this year's team before we jump into actual player talk?
I mean, it's kind of hard to really evaluate them as a unit. Just with so many moving pieces over the last couple of weeks coming back. I mean, they get two guys in their front court that they're going to need big time. They're starting to get healthy in that portion. So that'll be big. But I mean, I think I've seen some things that I like. I've seen some things that I don't like. I mean, I think it's pretty much the same for everyone really in November, early December. Nobody's playing their best ball yet.
Yeah.
I think this team's pretty much is what I expected, like an NIT level team. Nothing, you know, in particular that's going to stand out at you, but, you know, I think in general, both teams are going to match up pretty well in terms of talent level.
Now I want to talk about Qatari Richmond, cause he's kind of been the superstar for the team, I guess, at this point. What has he done over the offseason, and what's changed with his game? Because he's just seems like he's taken it to a complete other level from when his Syracuse days.
Yeah. I mean, the first thing I noticed the first game was that he looked in way better shape than he's been his entire career as a Pirate. But
yeah,
Gene Holloway mentioned it over the summer. That was his first real summer of having workouts and all that stuff. And it looked it, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Usually you got to worry about him kind of getting into playing shape as the year goes on. But he looks like he was right there at the beginning, ready to go, had a full summer of practice, which directly translated to playing well from the start. I remember last year, for instance, he looked like lost until really the Rutgers game is when he kind of turned it around. But he's playing great right now. I mean, he didn't play that well during Feast Week, but looked fantastic against Baylor.
Yeah, and that's what was the final score of that one? I don't even know, actually. I just had it pulled up.
It turned out to be a blowout at the end. They let it slide at the end, which is brutal for your metrics, but, you know, whatever.
It happens. It's a very good Baylor team, number 6 in the country, 78-60. But, he had another good game. Now, you guys run, like, a four-guard lineup, technically, even though the guards are, like, 6'6", 6'5"-ish?
Yeah. I mean, Dre Davis played as a four last year, too, off the bench, though, behind KC. I mean, I guess it's really kind of the same thing. I mean, KC was pretty much a guard for all intents and purposes. He's 6'5", you know?
Yeah.
Dre, I think, is 6'6", but he gets pretty much all the run at the four. It's nice to be able to have a little bit of space, but, I mean, it doesn't really matter if you got guys that can't knock down shots. But
yeah.
They're smaller. I know Pike last night went to the smaller lineup, too, so that'll be nice if we'll do that again on Saturday. But a lot of hopefully there's a change on Saturday on our end. Got to be a little bit of a shakeup, I think.
In terms of the starting lineup, you mean? Or
yeah, I think so.
What do you think potentially could ha or should happen, I guess?
I think it's not just me. It's everyone that is a Seton Hall fan wants to see Isaiah Coleman insert into the starting lineup. I mean, the kid's been fantastic. And, I mean, whether it's Wusu or Dawes, he's outplayed pretty much one of them, either of them, at every given night. So there's really no point why, you know, you keep running the same five. But, I mean, I kind of get it. You play the long game with a freshman. I mean, look how long it took Pike to get Gavin in.
That's true. Yeah. It's definitely interesting. But, yeah, I actually got a chance to see Seton Hall play against Northeastern another day. And the Coleman kid impressed the hell out of me. I didn't think he was a true freshman when I first saw him. And I was like, who the hell is that? And I'm like, oh, damn. And then I noticed Alamir Dawes, New Jersey native, is still very inconsistent. He'll have games where he goes off and games where there's like nothing going on.
Yeah. And that's kind of the beauty of having a guy like Coleman with this year's team as opposed to last year. You didn't really have that guy off the bench. You know, if you got a guy, whether it's Wusu, Coleman, I mean, Wusu, Dawes, you know, even, you know, Dre Davis in that extent, you just flip in Coleman. Like, he can give you production. He rebounds the basketball. He does a lot of things freshmen don't do. It's impressive, which is why I think people are like, play the kid.
Yeah. No, of course. Now, I'm not even familiar or that familiar with Coleman. Was he highly ranked? Was he who'd they beat out, I guess, in the long run for that recruitment?
So he was a late decommit. He decommitted in, like, I want to say, like, June, maybe July. I don't know. It was over the summer. Okay. But he was originally committed to Charleston. He was ranked pretty high from, like, when they first were connected to him, they, like, Andrews listed him as, like, a top 60 kid. Okay. When I saw him for the first time, he's like in like that 120 range, which probably is a factor of him committing to Charleston.
Yeah, of course.
But decommitted from Charleston, Seton Hall scooped him up. Thank God that happened because the kid has been a godsend.
Yeah, it's definitely interesting. Now, looking at the big men, obviously Bediako is the main big man for you guys. Ideally, in this matchup, I was looking forward to. I might have tweeted something a little too early. I might have said Cliff was probably going to eat his lunch, I think I said. After watching Cliff last night, I don't know if that's necessarily true anymore, but how would you just describe Bediako's game?
I mean, talk about a kid that you would have never thought is as good as he is. Like, didn't really put up numbers at all at Santa Clara. You're like, why are we bringing in this kid to probably be our starting center? And then you watch him play, and like, he's like so much better than I could have ever thought. Yeah. He's just your traditional banger. You know, he's not good. He doesn't do anything like overly athletic. He plays really hard, which is great. He's got a nice little low post game, offensive rebounding. I think like last someone said that he was like top like 10 in the country in offensive rebounding percentage or something like that, which is awesome. Okay.
Wow. Damn.
Yeah, he's a lot better of a player than I thought. But I mean, the one thing that scares me is when you got guys that are super athletic, they can just kind of run around them. I kind of saw it a little bit with Baylor, especially on pick and rolls.
Yeah.
It can be tough sometimes because the defense hasn't really been up to snuff. But kid's pretty good. He'll be able to hold his own at least against Cliff. Granted, like you mentioned, Cliff hasn't really looked like Cliff.
Yeah, that's a bigger issue on Rutgers' end. But, yeah, I noticed actually when at the game I went to, who was it? Chris Daugherty. He's a former Notre Dame guy from Northeastern. He kind of like in the first half definitely ate Bediako's lunch a little bit. It's that quicker, smaller big man, I guess, that always gives him fits.
Yeah, the athleticism aspect. He's a big banger, but he's, you know, he's got slow feet. You know, it is what it is. Great player. I love the kid, but he got his deficiencies.
Now, who else do they have in the front court? I know they have Elijah Hutchins Everett, who's probably the main backup big, and then I think Trubeck's out, if I read that correctly.
So I don't know what's going on with Tubek.
Tubek, sorry. Back
at the Eastern game that you were at. I love what I've seen from the kid. He's just an energizer bunny.
Yeah.
He's obviously super raw, but he's everywhere. So hopefully that he can get minutes because when he plays, it gives him a new kind of you know, dynamic, just having some more energy in that second unit. But who knows with that. His back was bothering him all summer and then said he tweaked it again the Baylor game. But we'll see. Shaw's not going to say anything until game time when he goes to check in, you know?
Of course.
But Hutchins Everett just came back too for the Baylor game. Was actually kind of impressed considering he hadn't practiced in 3 weeks. Looked pretty competent. All you really need him to do is give him like 10 to 12 minutes just to spell Bediako throughout the game. So I think that's a good role for him. He's a nice player. He's got some game. Another one too, just kind of big kind of not banger type. He's a little bit more skilled than Bediako is, but he's got slow feet too. So, you know, if you got a matchup against Cliff, it's going to be tough. You want to pick and roll against those guys, it's going to be tough. They struggle with it at times. as you saw the Northeastern game.
Yeah, no, it definitely happens. Looking at the offense and everything, it seems like it's a little bit of a slower paced offense than a typical Big East Seton Hall team. Am I correct in kind of reading that? Or
yes, but I noticed that this year they have small spurts where they create turnovers like crazy. It's just like it's just like back to back to back to back to back, and they get out and they run. But most of the time, it's like snail's pace. You know, they just want to move, and like they're taking shots at like 3 or 4 seconds left in the shot clock. There's not really much going on. The paces, I would like to honestly see them move faster. I don't know if it'll ever happen. I'm sure you probably think the same thing after hearing you know, summer. You know, we're going to play faster, we're going to do this, and then you watch games, you know, like it's the same thing.
Yep.
But I mean, I think part of that too is that Kadari Richmond's a very kind of like slow and methodical kind of like kid, like player wise. You know, he like slows the game down. That's just kind of his style. He's not really in a rush. So I think that has a lot to do with it too. But I mean, half court, it's tough.
Yeah.
you want to see some more runouts because you get better looks that way when you can't score in the half court.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it seems like almost like they're not running like, and I could be wrong because I I've watched one game and I was half watching, half not watching for the sole fact that I was just hanging out with my buddies and boys and everything. But it just seemed like it was just little to no sets at all on offense. It was just kind of like, here, Kadari, go see if you could score. If you can't, then maybe Bediako cleans it up and throws it back out to someone else.
Yeah, I mean, best offense really the last couple of like their big games has been throw the ball at the backboard and the rim and let's see if you get the rebound.
Yeah.
But I mean, I notice sometimes they'll run a couple of things like easy quick hitters for Bediako down on the block just to get him in good position. Sometimes they run stuff for pause, but not enough. Yeah, I think if you ask anyone, they'd say we want to see some more sets because you watch that St. Peter's team, their offense was like flawless for most of those games, you know?
Yeah.
They were these beautiful sets and haven't really seen them yet.
Yeah. looking back at some of these games that the Seton Hall has lost between USC, Iowa, and Baylor, I'm sure you watched all three of them. What is the main issue, you would say, in these losses? Is there one specific thing or is it a different thing kind of every game?
I would say the biggest thing, especially in the Feast Week games, is they start way too slow. Like USC and Iowa, they both jumped out. Actually, no, the USC game, not as much. It was close, and then they kind of like went to sleep for 10 minutes. But they went into the half, I think they were down like 12 or something like that. Like,
yeah,
it was close at the half. So you got to expend all that energy to get back into the game. Then by the time you do, you know, if you're only going seven guys deep, you're going to get back into the game, and then you're going to get exhausted and get blown out.
Yeah.
Which has pretty much been the theme for all those games. Now, like I said, having two back gives you a little bit of more depth there, which is big. Be able to spell some of those other guys a little bit, especially Dre Davis, who just plays all game, basically.
Yeah.
But, I mean, they got to start fast. The good news is Rutgers is kind of in the same boat, you know, so the game could very easily be 8-8 at the U-12 on Saturday. You know what I mean? It wouldn't surprise me at all.
Yeah. And like we said before, it's a sold out game, so that crowd is going to play a factor. What's kind of the feeling like among the Seton Hall fan base going into this one?
I mean, I think a lot of people overreacted to the Baylor game just because the scoreline was so unflattering at the end. But I mean, the reality is they went into Baylor, who honestly could be a top 2-3 team in college basketball. Their offense is insane.
Yeah, of course.
You played them good for, you know, almost three quarters of the game, a little over three quarters of the game. What more could you have asked for there? You were 12-point dogs. You weren't going to be, you know, in the running to win the game. You just wanted to be in it, and you pretty much were. But at the end, they kind of let it slip, and, you know, the scoreline was unflattering. So I think people are a little down on this team. I mean, people are down on it anyway just because we had so many good teams over so many years with the end of the Willard kind of era. People want more, which is totally, like, totally reasonable. I obviously do, too. But,
yeah.
I mean, to have reasonable expectations kind of in the new era, you know, kind of things are changing, you know, NIL right now, they're still playing a little bit of catch up. The roster isn't as good as some of the years past.
Yeah.
But I mean, I got to think people after seeing Rutgers against Wake last night are probably like, okay, a little more optimistic. Plus it's at the Pru. And I forget, Jerry mentioned it on the someone's podcast. It was Dino's, but when was the last time that Rutgers won at the Pru? I think it was when they were big, right?
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, because it's always been the home team for the most part that's winning. And I think Seton Hall actually changed that recently, too, because they won a Jersey Mike's or Rack, whatever the fuck you want to call it. But yeah, no, it's been a while. So, yeah, I guess home court plays a role.
Absolutely, especially in this game, because it's You get two rabid fan bases. Whoever's the home team is like everyone just totally hates the other side.
Oh yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, I wanted to talk about that a little bit more in depth too. Like, so obviously you're a Seton Hall guy. Are you just born and then it was like, hey, here's a blue jersey, or is it like, did you like, how'd you get into Seton Hall? Like, how'd you get involved with the fan base and everything? And after all that, I want to know how you or what made you create a JP Carlissimo account.
That's a good question. So, my dad went to Seton Hall, so I've been watching Seton Hall forever. So kind of like the jersey on. I've seen them. I started watching them back in like the Louis Orr era, like with like the Kelly Whitneys, the Andre Barretts, those guys. That was kind of like my christening to Seton Hall basketball. But yeah, in terms of why did I make a burner, honestly. So like I live in Rhode Island. All my friends are PC fans. I don't have anyone that I can really talk about Seton Hall hoops with. So I was just like, whatever. I'll just make a Twitter burner account. Like I'll just shoot the shit with like some of these like Hall fans. So that way, like you just whatever, talk to some folks. And also, I'm like completely unhinged. I would just literally yell thoughts into space about this team if I could, but people listen for whatever reason. So that's kind of the reason why I ended up making a burner. But it's fun, you watch games, you just tweet shit emotionally. Everything is pretty much emotional in the moment. There's really no rational things, and it's just kind of fun to also like games like this, right? Spark the shit,
Yeah,
like
exactly.
tweet about the upper bowl because I know it pisses people off. You
Oh yeah.
know what I mean? Stuff like that. It's fun.
I mean, I'm not even gonna mention it. Well, I'm gonna mention it now. I haven't mentioned it at all on Twitter, and you can feel free to do something with this if you want. Rutgers fans are gonna be pissed because this is the first time I think it's came out. But apparently, so Seton Hall's athletic department didn't give the same allotment to Rutgers that they usually give. A lot less ticket allotment to Rutgers students and fans or whatever. Usually they give like a couple of like Rutgers to say, hey, here's for your students. They can come. It's a cool atmosphere, blah, blah, blah. This year it's just like, hey, here's your t tickets for the team. Fuck out of here. Maybe
That's
not
awesome.
from that aspect, but it's still it creates a little bit more of a rivalry.
See, though, I like that. Like, I like that Seton Hall kind of doesn't allow. It's going to sound like very ridiculous saying this, but I like that they're kind of capping the Rutgers people because if you go to the rack, it's so small in there, and there's so many season ticket holds anyway. There's only like so little tickets that you can have. So when you play there, true home court advantage for
Oh
Rutgers.
yeah.
So why shouldn't we do the same?
No, I don't disagree. I think it's interesting. I think it's it and it builds the rivalry. You need to make this thing a little. I know like in recent years it's been pretty good, but I need another level of this year. I need it to get hostile as shit. Like I need screaming. I need the students cursing out this guy and this guy flipping off this guy. I mean, Rutgers fans got who the hell was it? They got Ed Cooley to fucking go bonkers after a press conference afterwards, and his strength and conditioning coach is sitting here like this, flipping the bird at the student section. And it's like, yo, if he
That
can
was
do that, like, let's see
amazing.
what. Yeah, that I couldn't believe that. That was just absolutely amazing.
Although today, no, that's the kind of the good thing about Rutgers right now with their recruiting really taking off. The next step with this rivalry is when both teams are good. Because we haven't had games where both teams were like really good. Like the only time I can really think of like when both teams were like at the same, not like I don't want to say the same level because that Seton Hall team was incredible.
Yeah, I know what you're gonna say.
But they went into the rack and got blown out. Rutgers was really good that year. You know what I mean? Like there hasn't been like if you can get it so that there's like two like pretty good Rutgers Seton Hall teams, that'll really elevate it. Because it's basically kind of like one fan base is like, all right, like we suck, or like, all right, we're pretty good. And then like you play it, it's like, all right, fuck these guys. So we kind of like, you know what I mean? Instead of like, all right, we're good, all right, we're good, fuck these guys.
No, I think it definitely even like this year alone, like Rutgers is coming in off of 18-point loss to or 18, I think it was 18. 18-point loss to Wake Forest last night, and just Seton Hall is coming off a tough loss to arguably one of the top teams in the country. So I just think fans are just not realizing, like, even though Rutgers kind of looks bad, this game everyone wakes up for this one on both sides. Like it's gonna be a battle no matter what. These teams could be, I think they're both in like the 80s in the KenPom or net right now, so it's gonna be similar, but well, yeah, if you can get both teams in the top 25, like it just would make an insane. And that's when you open the upper deck fully.
No, when that does happen, if that does happen, I don't know. I don't really have an idea of what the future really kind of holds for Seton Hall. Obviously, Rutgers have right, with, you know, the way that they can bring kids in. So
yeah, I mean, definitely helps to have some NIL support behind that one. But yeah, I wanted to ask you about that. How's I know you just said they're still playing catch up with NIL, but is there a collective at Seton Hall? How's it work there so far for NIL?
Yeah, so they hired a GM. I want to say it was over the summer. And honestly, he's come in, and again, I'm not involved in it in any way. I just kind of look at it from a fan's perspective. I personally think he's doing a pretty good job of things, because when he came in, there was a couple different collectives. It was a mess, kind of. Mm-hmm. You put them all together. Basically, they have one Onward Setonia, is what they're calling it now. Okay. We dropped some jerseys a couple weeks ago. Those are sweet. Like, you know, just kind of cool stuff, like get fan engagement. Mm-hmm. What the pool is going to look like, it's kind of hard to say. I don't really know, like, how that works. Like, I know obviously you have like your big donors and things, yeah, like, but I mean, I've long said it, I don't think Seton Hall needs to have a pool as big as Rutgers does, because that's just not who they are. Like, in terms mm-hmm. of program historically, they're going to develop kids.
Yeah,
you know, you have one or two good kids, and then the rest you develop into good players. That's who they are as a program. Mm-hmm. So I think the number that ideally they need to get to is very much in reach in the next couple of years. But NIL has definitely kind of become more of a thing for Seton Hall. They're focusing on it. Very happy with the steps that they've been taking. A lot more events and things like that.
Yeah.
Just to raise money outside of just, hey, give me a check kind of things.
Yeah.
So.
I mean, it seems like it actually starts today, tomorrow. I don't know when that Garden State Hardwood Classic Banquet thing is. Because I know a couple of players are attending that, and they're going to get some kind of NIL payday out of it or whatever it is. But the reason I ask, I guess, the most is because you mentioned before Isaiah Coleman's been great as a freshman. And I've noticed people on Twitter, and I don't know if you specifically said it or someone else, but people are like, you know what? Like, NIL is going to play a factor after this season, because you know how all the big boys are going to come after him. And it's just kind of how the way the world works, right?
Yeah, man. Price of the brick going up on that kid, that's for sure.
Yeah.
But again, it's just kind of one of those things with NIL where, I mean, I'm sure every coach in the country will say it. The first thing you do is recruit your roster at the end of the year. Mm-hmm. Even if kids aren't in the portal, you know, people yeah. are going to reach out to them. Mm-hmm. You know, they sit in there happy as a clam. Like, I look at, like, Tay Davis, for instance. Mm-hmm. You know, obviously he's from Indiana. Micah gets the job at Notre Dame. He's not in the portal. And then mm-hmm. you start hearing rumblings about him getting in the portal. So I'm assuming yeah. dollar amount given to him before he entered the portal.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's kind of standard practice for a lot of coaches, not just to throw Mike yeah. on.
No, I mean, I can confirm for a fact Micah has tampered with half of Rutgers' roster too, so.
Yeah, I mean, I figure it's safe to use Micah because it's like well common known, like, knowledge at this point that he's
yeah.
deep.
I mean, Ed Cooley too. That's the big reason why Rutgers fans were kind of attacking the shit out of him. I'm saying fuck Ed Cooley during the whole entire game.
I know, I kind of forgot about that Cam Spencer thing until someone yeah. said it. I was like, why are they like so pissed off at Ed Cooley? I was like, mm-hmm. oh yeah. Right over the summer, but
kind of scummy, kind of a scummy guy.
At least. But to the Coleman thing, though,
yeah,
someone is going to offer him a lot mm-hmm. of money, and that's kind of the thing with recruiting now, is you got to find kids. Like, you look at there's a kid at Colorado State, I can't think of his name right now, but the point guard, he's really good. You know, like, kind of pocket.
Yeah, I'm not good with names.
You got to find kids that like are committed to your program. But I mean, they don't really exist that much. Like, there's not many of them. Isaiah Coleman's one of those guys, because I know for a fact if someone says, you know, hey, like, here's an insane amount of money, so, you know, it's probably not going to be able to match that. That's just mm-hmm. not who they are.
Yeah.
You know, but I hope that kid stays, because he's fantastic and he could really be, you know, one of the next great ones at Seton Hall.
Mm-hmm. So now it's year two under Shaheen. What are kind of expectations going forward? I know this year you said potential NIT team. And how do you feel he's fared so far? I know he's kind of gotten through, everyone was hyping him up as a recruiter, but then the NIL thing came into play, so it kind of threw everything for a loop.
Yeah, I mean, as a recruiter, I mean, you could definitely see it. Like, his first year, he's in the running with these top 50 kids, but he doesn't, you know, he's going into a sword fight with a spoon, yeah. you know, for those kids, because those kids are getting, you know, big money, you know, just from, you know, being a
recruiter. Yeah, of course. Kid, right?
So as a recruiter, I mean, he's pretty much done all he can. He just kind of needs more help financially, which I think you're starting to see. Like, look at their 24 class. They got 2 4 stars coming in.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So got to be, you know, some additional kind of support coming there. Mm-hmm. But I mean, in terms of what he's done, I think he really got a bad rap for last year, you know, mm-hmm. being an NIT team. He won 10 games in the Big East, though. Like, I mean, his roster was in flux the entire year. Beat UConn. Like, he went into Rutgers' first game there as a coach and won it. Like, he did some really good things, and I think people were really sour on him just because they didn't make the tournament, which is fair. Like I said, expectations around the program are pretty much NCAA or bust. But I mean, I think he's done pretty well. Are there things that he could do better? Absolutely. Starting with the staff for one. Maybe a little bit better in-game execution. But I mean, I think all in all, he's done a pretty good job since he's took over at Seton Hall. I mean, he's still kind of figuring out high major too, right? It's a lot of but what the future holds is really going to depend on the NIL situation, which I'm starting to get confident in.
That's a good sign of things. So things to come for Seton Hall. Last thing I got for you, probably just a game prediction. I know it's Saturday night. Yes, Sunday night. I don't even remember anymore. I think it's Saturday night. Yeah, my brain is mush since this whole like transfer portal thing happened for football. So I'm lost right now. Plus, Dylan Harper, was on my mind for like a year at this point, and it's done. So I can kind of,
Congrats on that.
yeah, that was a big one.
That's a class.
Some genius guy predicted FutureCaster crystal ball back in May. I don't know who that guy was, but he seems
Yeah,
like a genius.
take your victory laps. You deserve it. Shit got murky for a little while, and you said, "Nah, not gonna happen."
No, I was very confident in it. But yeah, anyway, Saturday night, big game, 8:30, Prudential Center. What do you think is going to happen, and who do you think wins?
Well, I think the first thing I can say is that it's not going to be in the 40s again. It's definitely going to be a rock fight. I think anyone's going to really score. I mean, who's going to win? I don't know. I can really see it kind of coming down to the wire, just like I feel like games really do, especially even. But I got to think being at Seton Hall, the crowd's going to be super rowdy. Like you mentioned, more Hall fans this year than normal. So I think that's going to eventually kind of give the budge, especially just like we mentioned, they haven't won at the Prudential Center in a decade. So I'm going to take my Pirates. I know I'll probably, catch a lot of shit for that. Because,
No, that's
fucking, whatever. But it is what it is. I think looking at this kind of feather neutral kind of look, I think it'd probably favor Seton Hall just being the home team. If it was at Rutgers, I'd probably say Rutgers is probably going to win. But I'm going to say 62 to 57 final.
Oh, you're really talking about a rock fight.
Well, I mean,
It's fair. No, that's fair.
neither of us can score. I mean, I don't see a way this game will go into the 70s unless everyone's just making shots. Like if the regression sets in from last year's game, not miss. But I'm not overly confident in that.
That's perfectly fair. So yeah, that's really all I got for you. I guess last question, or not even question. Got any final thoughts? And where can people find you on social media? I know obviously at JP Carlissimo on Twitter, but
No, I'm just on Twitter. Just tweeting angry shit during games mostly.
It's
But
fair.
yeah, that's it. Just Twitter. I don't have any Instagrams or anything like that.
You're slacking, dude. You gotta upgrade a little bit.
Oh, man, I don't feel like running an Instagram too. That's too much. I do
Nah.
Facebook every now and then. That's good enough for me. And I jump on podcasts. That's
There you
poor.
go. There you go. For me and JP, that's another edition of the Night Report podcast, signing off.